Welcome to the InfoWars Nightly News. It's Friday, January 16th, 2015, and I'm Leanne McAdoo. Here are tonight's top stories.
Tonight, the father of the latest U.S. terror suspect says that his son was set up by the feds. And our global warming alarmist just blowing hot air? That's next on the InfoWars Nightly News.
You got the Pope out there pushing carbon taxing. Australia's getting rid of it because they implemented it first and it wrecked their economy. It's wrecked the Spanish economy over in Spain.
North Miami Beach police sparked outrage after it was revealed that they were using the mugshots of former felons for target practice. And what's sure to foment all of the anger and this theory that black lives do not matter when it comes to relations with the police. Six of the mugshots being used were of black men. The seventh was a computer-generated image of what seemed to be a white man. And additionally, the sister of one of the men whose picture was riddled with bullet holes was the one who discovered these targets. This was Florida Army National Guard Sergeant Valerie Dient, and her and her other guardsmen arrived at a shooting range where she found that the people who had previously used the range, the North Miami Beach Police Department snipers, had been firing at old mugshots. She discovered one of them was her brother, Woody, who spent 4 years in prison after a conviction 15 years ago. Woody, when he was asked about it, said, "I'm not even like that. I'm a career man. I've got a family. I work 9 to 5. Now, rather than apologize, the police chief said his department would stop using human targets until they amass enough targets to depict a more racially diverse blend of criminals. He said that his snipers are, a lot of them are minority, so they didn't do anything wrong here. He did say, however, that they would stop using mugshots and in the future they would instruct the police to remove the targets when they're done. You think? So there it is. It was really more of a matter of them getting caught doing this. So of course, this is gonna do little to quell the fears of a lot of people who think that the police here in America are being trained to fire upon American citizens in anticipation of some unknown cataclysmic event. But are these targets any worse than the ones being bought by the DHS to the tune of $2 million, $2 million taxpayer dollars? Now, we reported on these in 2013. They were realistic, no more hesitation targets, and they featured images of pregnant women, elderly people, and children. All of these people were pictured holding guns, supposedly designed to give officers the experience of dealing with deadly force shooting scenarios with subjects that are not the norm during training. So, I mean, what is worse here? It's all terrible. It's all basically training the police to fire upon American citizens, even those that they wouldn't normally fire upon, which, you know, here I guess it's normally the mugshots of black men. But you notice how none of these targets actually look like people who are committing terror plots. No, and while continuing to use, you know, pregnant women and in the elderly, the West wants to continue arming moderate rebels, people who are actually going out there and committing terror. These are who we should really be worried about. But no, we're going to continue arming them. Now, these are moderate rebels who recently defected to ISIS. We reported that they brought with them weapons, cash, equipment, and the training that was provided to them by Saudi Arabia, Qatar, the US, and the UK. And it was reported that some 3,000 moderate rebels of the Free Syrian Army had defected to the Islamic State. The Daily Beast reported in September, Al-Qaeda plotters in Syria went dark. And then this group would later be reported as having surrendered to Al-Qaeda. That's how the International Business Times painted that picture. But with brigade size defection to ISIS, you would think that the last thing that the United States would want to do is send an even bigger brigade or train even more of these moderate rebels. But that's exactly what they did. The U.S. was preparing to train another brigade-sized army to arm, fund, train them, and turn them loose in Syria. And of course, they are going to eventually be filtered into Europe and America. Stars and Stripes reported that the officials were going to be training an additional round of 5,000 of these Free Syrian Army members within about a year. Now, Following the arrests of more than a dozen people this week with suspected links to Islamic terrorism, following the attacks there in Paris, European counterterrorism agencies are now scrambling to deal with the effects, the potential danger of this really complex issue of a growing terrorism threat. A Western intelligence source told CNN that as many as 20 sleeper cells of between 120 and 180 people could be ready to strike in France, Germany, Belgium, and the Netherlands. And it is believed that ISIS directed these men to return to Europe to launch attacks in retaliation for airstrikes against the terror group in Syria and Iraq. This was according to that same official. And we just reported yesterday a really phenomenal report out by Joe Biggs and John Bowne talking about these very same sleeper cells that are being allowed and catered to here in the United States. So we're quite aware of the same exact sleeper cells. Definitely check that report out. But you can already see the very people who helped to create these terrorists and create this mess wringing their hands at the thought of taking away even more of our freedoms in order to deal with the mess that they created. Today, the UK and the US announced a joint anti-terror plans. This was David Cameron and Barack Obama. They've announced new measures to combat extremism, including, you guessed it, even more airstrikes, which is what they were saying that they're sending all of these jihadis to the West to retaliate for these airstrikes. But they promise, Cameron and Obama promise, it is a fight. We know how we will win.
With our allies, we will confront it wherever it appears. In Iraq, the UK is the second largest contributor to the anti-ISIL coalition. RAF aircraft have conducted over 100 strikes and will continue to play a leading role. We will deploy additional intelligence and surveillance assets to help Iraqi forces on the ground. And we will ensure they are better trained and equipped to counter explosive devices.
And the two countries say they will also share intelligence in an effort to learn from one another's experiences. I guess that means they're going to be sharing even more intelligence, even more of our private data. But they've also agreed to stage cyber war games. And this is an effort to boost each country's resistance to hack attacks. So the writing's on the wall. Expect to see more cyber war, more cyber false flags, and we can also expect to see some more FBI bomb plots thwarted by, that's right, you guessed it, the FBI. Now, this is following the pattern of the vast majority of previous domestic terror threats that have been cooked up by the FBI. Authorities say that the 20-year-old Christopher Lee Cornell planned to detonate pipe bombs and then fire on fleeing lawmakers and employees earlier this week. But his family is asserting that this young man was never capable of coordinating or funding such a conspiracy on his own. They say he was a mama's boy. Now, when Cornell began tweeting out his support for ISIS under an assumed name, he attracted the attention of the FBI. Now, one could say that this is just a 20-year-old loner, probably just out there searching for attention. But federal authorities saw it as an opportunity, and they set up a meeting with an FBI informant in Cincinnati over 2 days in October. And his father says they were taking him somewhere and they were filling his head with lots of this garbage. And he also disputes the claim that his son bought two semi-automatic rifles and 600 rounds of ammunition from a store in Ohio because he notes that his son only had $1,200 in his bank account and the guns alone would have cost almost $2,000. He said, where did that money come from? Well, it came from the FBI and they set him up. So sound familiar? We have heard this before. They've done this before when they've filled a truck with fertilizer so someone could drive it to the World Trade Center. And of course, the media as usual rallied around this false flag agenda and they're putting up pictures of Cornell showing him with a question 9/11 and 9/11 was an inside job sticker and everything to, of course, try and tie him to the truth movement. Did not stop lawmakers from immediately seizing upon this FBI created threat to call for more NSA surveillance and justify this continuation of the surveillance state, you know, because they got to fight terrorism. Now, Boehner said, We would have never known about this had it not been for the FISA program and our ability to collect information on people who pose an imminent threat. Boehner said, we would have never known about this had it not been for the FISA program and our ability to collect information on people who pose an imminent threat. But according to an FBI affidavit, authorities were tipped off by an informant who saw tweets posted by Cornell, just like the Boston bomber was found by a homeowner and not the thousands of militarized police who went out looking for him. Now, Boehner didn't give a pat on the back to the FBI for disrupting the very terror plot that they once again created. Nah, he just wants to credit the good old Patriot Act, and we need more of it. And that's exactly what we heard in the days immediately following the attacks here in Paris. They said that they're going to be begging us for all the data that we've been able to collect, and we're going to share it. Of course, the U.S. and the U.K. announced that that's indeed what they're going to start doing, joining forces today. Really, we're really seeing the ramp up and this push for a one-world government and kind of just swirling chaos and terror all around in every part of the world in order to further this agenda. When will people stop buying this play? Because they're not going to stop until they take away every last bit of our freedom in the name of protecting us from terror. Now, coming up later in the show, I'm going to be speaking with Mark Morano of ClimateDepot.com, and he's going to be discussing the very UN agenda to do just that through the guise of environmental protection.
Every year we make resolutions to lose weight and get in shape. And the truth is, it's hard, even with diet and exercise, because of toxic food and our environment that is stressing our bodies more than ever before. Working with experts in nutrition and biochemistry, I found that super high quality nutraceuticals, in addition to my diet and exercise, were the answers that synergistically worked. I could see the drastic changes every day with the amount of weight I've lost, my increased stamina, and more of a twinkle in my eye. That's why we are now so excited to launch the InfoWars Life Resolution Pack, combining three essential formulations: oxygen-based cleanser Oxy Powder, the Secret 12 bioavailable vitamin B12, and your choice of Super Female or Super Male Vitality. Now all available at a discounted price to you and your family to bring in the new year and make 2015 a true success. That's InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. 2015 is the year to do it, and it all starts at InfoWarsLife.com.
City of Austin tap water versus filtered City of Austin tap water.
I can, like, taste dirt in it.
God knows what's in this.
This has an aftertaste. Tastes like Austin water.
Yeah, it does. Ugh.
These people just sampled City of Austin tap water straight from the faucet. Next, we had them try a sample of tap water filtered with a ProPure G2.0 filtration system.
High quality H2O.
That one is better.
Tastes like nothing.
Yep, I know what good water tastes like. It's good water.
Most tap water contains added substances like fluoride, chlorine, Monsanto's deadly pesticide, glyphosate, and many others. Studies prove that these substances are linked to an assortment of major health issues, including tooth decay, lowered IQ, and even cancer.
It tastes like you're drinking out of the lake when you're drinking tap water.
Yeah, it has that processed flavor to it.
The ProPure G2.0 filtration system removes these deadly substances and many more, leaving only fresh-tasting, deliciously clean water.
Okay, this is very tasty.
It's good water.
Refreshing.
It's good.
Go to InfoWarsStore.com today. Use promo code WATER and save 10% off your ProPure purchase. Again, that's InfoWarsStore.com or call 1-888-253-3139.
Gas prices have fallen far and fallen quickly, but don't celebrate yet. It's a manipulated price, and behind it are some horrific trends. Before we talk about those trends, I want to give you a quick comparison and some historical perspective.
I just bought gas for $1.79 a gallon and a 20-ounce bottle of water for $1.29. That's $8.25 per gallon for refrigerated water. Of course, I can get a gallon of unrefrigerated water at a retail grocer for around a dollar, but there are also huge taxes on the gas. In Texas, that's 38 cents per gallon, federal and state, much cheaper than the high gas tax states of, say, California, New York, or Pennsylvania, where you'll pay up to 65 cents a gallon. So taking out the taxes, I paid $1.40 per gallon.
Think about that for a moment. A dollar a gallon for just taking some water, pouring it into a jug, and shipping it to retail versus $1.40 per gallon for exploring for the oil, developing a well. If that doesn't work out, they start all over again. Once it does work out, they have to ship it to a refinery, refine it, then ship it again to retail.
Of course, Saudi Arabia doesn't have any exploration or startup costs. They're just looking at production costs, and their production costs are very low, estimated to be about $20 per barrel. They have said they believe U.S. shale cost is about $50 per barrel. They can easily live with $40 per barrel. Still, 100% profit. They've been getting 500 to 600% profit. 0% interest rates haven't helped the global economy. Neither has printing money, and not even drastically lower oil prices are expected to help.
Here's the most important thing that nobody is talking about. The global economy has weakened so much, so quickly, that in just the last few months, the Saudis were able to cut the price of oil in half by just maintaining production levels. That's how weak the global economy is. So enjoy that gas that's about the price of water right now. It's a sugar fix. It's a Trojan horse by the Saudis so that they can regain and keep control of the world's oil supply. And then they will charge you accordingly.
Most economists say, oh, it's good for the consumer. Well, of course it is. We save maybe $2 a day at lower oil prices, but it's going to burst one of the biggest bubbles we've had recently, the fracking bubble. We were told we're going to be energy independent, and we got this great fracking revolution. It's just a bubble industry. Without 5% junk bond rates, the lowest we've ever seen in history, normally 8 to 10% for those type of high-risk lending. And without $100-plus oil prices, fracking doesn't work. So fracking is dead. That's a million jobs. That's $980 billion in investment that's going to go bad and $500 trillion in debt.
And it's not just oil that's declining. Other commodities are as well. A metric of 24 commodities shows a drop of 43% since 2011, with 28% of that coming in just the last 7 months. And that's part of a long-term trend.
In history, when you try to cure debt with debt, you end up either in an inflationary blowout and or a deflationary crash. And we see, and we've been saying consistently,
deflationary
leadership and a lot of very smart people who understand the debt crisis is unsustainable, we've been saying, no, this ends in deflation. And all we've seen, Europe's worried about deflation. U.S. is worried about deflation. Commodity prices are collapsing. Older people are deflationary. Young people cost everything to raise. Old people downsize everything.
And with deflation accelerating, the other D word comes to mind, depression.
As we saw with the Great Depression, economic hardship brings civil unrest. And our government has been preparing for civil unrest.
It's war. The greatest concentration of fighting troops in Washington since 1865.
I knew something was going to happen, that they might be attacked. And I had a press card, so I passed the police lines, and then I saw the soldiers advancing, and they started throwing tear gas. I'd never seen anything like it.
To prevent civil war and a major economic collapse, governments will start foreign wars. And the U.S. is laying the groundwork for war with Russia. And if the Russian economy collapses, they will want a foreign enemy too. War with Russia has already begun, with Western-funded revolution in Ukraine, economic sanctions, and with the CIA and the Saudis targeting Russia's most important economic sector, energy. The CIA's ally, Saudi Arabia, is once more working against the interests of our country.
And working to make us dependent on foreign oil, something the military-industrial complex has used to push us into wars throughout the 20th century, and engaging directly in economic warfare on Russia, pushing us towards real war as the world slips from deflation into depression. For InfoWars Nightly News, I'm David Knight.
Sold out for weeks due to the difficult and extensive proprietary process behind its creation, the exclusive InfoWars Life Secret 12 formulation is now back in stock. in the last limited shipment of 2014. The most bioactive form that has been created with our proprietary process. This ultra-clean vitamin B12 nutraceutical has been carefully crafted and developed over the last 2 years and is based on cellular science of how your body actively absorbs essential nutrients. Secret 12 is taken by mouth, right on the tongue, and then swallowed. No needles, no injections. Vitamin B12 deficiency is linked to scores of serious problems. And Secret 12 is a fusion of two organic proprietary forms of vitamin B12, bringing you a true nutraceutical quality vitamin B12, Secret 12. Secret 12 is an excellent Christmas gift and is tailor-made to boost your New Year's resolutions. Supplies of Secret 12 are very limited. Secure yours today at InfoWarsLife.com or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139.
Well, it's very puzzling to understand just what is going on with global warming. Every day there seems to be some new apocalyptic story in the news, as well as a counterclaim saying, what are you talking about, global warming? Your scientist's ship is stuck in polar ice for weeks and they have to be rescued. I mean, here are just a sampling of some of the headlines from Drudge today. The heat is on. NOAA and NASA say 2014 is the warmest year on record. Third time in a decade, the globe has sizzled to its highest yet. New York Times is also agreeing that it's the hottest year on record, surpassing even 2010. The Washington Post says scientists say human activity has pushed Earth beyond 4 of 9 planetary boundaries. And at the rate things are going, the Earth in the coming decades could cease to be a safe operating space for human beings. So, of course, that's the push to get the elites off the planet, right? They're going to destroy this one and maybe set up shops somewhere else. Well, my guest today is one of those dissenting voices. His article is there up at the top of Drudge Report. Scientists balk at hottest year claims, ignoring satellites showing 18-year pause. Mark Morano is best known as the founder of ClimateDepot.com, which really works to promote a positive voice on environment and development issues and really push back against all of this apocalyptic rhetoric that basically just extorts the public under the guise of environmental protection. Mark, thank you for joining us today. So we've got the global warming establishment really continuing with this chaos campaign. Not only is the sky falling, I mean, the climate is pretty much ruined and there's no turning back. But what you point out in your article is that we're dealing with dueling sets of data. How so?
Yeah, right now, today, they're declaring it's the hottest. Last year was the hottest year on record. Of course, records go back to the late 19th century. So first of all, that's kind of laughable that we're only talking 120 years. Second of all, they're comparing coverage of temperatures way back in the 19th century, which was nowhere near as good, even the early part of the 20th century. They're really comparing apples and oranges and the way things have been measured and the way things have changed. Beyond that, they are basically ignoring satellite data, which was actually set up by NASA to be more accurate, which shows that we're 18 years plus in global warming pause or standstill or no temperature change, which means every kid in high school today has never had a day of global warming in their life. So what they've done is they've got adjusted surface data, and they're trying to claim it's the hottest year on record. Well, the problem is the pause, global warming pause continues, so the way they make it sound like it's the hottest, they're talking about hundreds of a degree Fahrenheit, which you can't even measure by thermometer. It's a statistical anomaly. It's meaningless. And they actually admit this in previous NASA press releases, but they're not announcing that today. And they're claiming that these statistically meaningless differences mean it's a record hot year, when in reality, it's a fancy way of saying the global warming pause continues. This is nothing but orchestrated politics. They're using climate data. They adjust it, monkey around with it, and they come up with statistically meaningless data, and then they claim politically meaningful concepts, which is we better do something, Congress needs to act, we need to sign UN treaties. This is all orchestrated. The Obama administration issues a similar type reports, making all sorts of scary global warming predictions, and these are federal government scientists. They know where the bread is buttered. So they go along with the politics of it. At the same time, they're allowing the data to be bastardized and prostituted, if you will, in the service of politics. And that's exactly what anyone who claims hottest year last year means. And by the way, scientists are laughing at this. One scientist actually said, I hope you laugh out loud if someone tells you it was the hottest year on record. it's just total nonsense from beginning to end, but it's powerful nonsense. And it's meaningful nonsense because this is what they're going to do to ram a new UN climate treaty down our throats. This is what they're using to ram EPA regulations down our throats. This is what they're using to, quote, fundamentally transform our economy, unquote, as the United Nations stated goal is to do, is fundamentally transform the way of life of everyone on the planet in order to fight global warming.
Right. And you point out this pause that they're really refusing to bring into their data. But when people do speak about it, they say, oh, well, our government policies are responsible for the pause. So basically, we should push even harder. This was an article out of the Daily Mail. They said warming may have decreased, but just shows how good these green policies are working.
Yes, excellent point, Leanne. This is true medieval witchcraft. In other words, if you cast a spell on someone as a witch and something bad happens to them, you can go around and say, I cast that spell and look what happened. They got in a car accident. They are literally claiming, a UK energy minister, as you just mentioned, the UK Daily Mail, that the pause in global warming, 18 years, 3 months to be exact, and counting, was due to all these green energy policies. And somehow the solar and wind subsidies and all this central planning of our energy economy and shutting down coal plants and carbon offsets and carbon taxes and all the stuff that everyone's been doing has resulted in the global warming slowing down. Hallelujah, right? The problem is CO2 levels have continued to rise despite all of this silly central planning alleged energy solutions to global warming. So there's no way that could be correct, but they're actually starting to take credit for the pause. And this is, again, true medieval witchcraft. It's true astrology. It's like your horoscope that would say a bunch of vague things. You know, you will make much money in your life or something, and then you win the lottery one day. Hey, my horoscope predicted it. They were right. It's the most basis of anyone with a base note level of logic can see through it. But they're actually presenting this as science now, and that's where it gets incredibly scary, because this is moronic science from beginning to end when they start claiming stuff like that.
Right, and we've seen so many instances throughout history where they say the science is settled, the earth is flat, we don't need your dissenting opinion, and the science isn't settled on this, yet it is almost like witchcraft, because they're really pushing out this propaganda and tricking everyone so that they can say it's the warmest year on record, period, don't even question it, these are the facts, and here are the policies that we need to put in place to magically make it disappear.
And they do it through these allegedly prestigious institutions like NASA. And everyone has generally a good opinion of NASA. Well, let's take a look at NASA and global warming. The man who just stepped down about 2 years ago was Dr. James Hansen. And he was the lead global warming scientist in the U.S. He's been arrested at least 6 times protesting energy development based on the fact that he believes we can't have any more coal plants or oil pipelines because the Earth can't handle it and we're all going to die. James Hansen, NASA's lead global warming scientist, endorsed a book calling for ridding the world of industrial civilization, for raising cities, blowing up dams, and turning off our greenhouse gas machine. James Hansen, NASA's lead global warming scientist, now retired just a year or two ago, said that the author of that book had it exactly right. The book sounded like it was written by the Unabomber, but NASA's lead global warming scientist gave the book praise, and it's actually on Amazon.com. It's a book by Keith Barnish. It's actually on Amazon.com. It's a jacket sleeve of the book. NASA's lead global warming scientist endorsing this book. He said that he's also, just to show you his agenda, Leanne, the NASA Global Warming Institution, the lead scientist, Hansen, had said that global warming coal was equivalent to the trains that took Jews to Nazi Germany. They made all sorts of Nazi analogies. He said that skeptics were guilty of crimes against humanity, implying we should be subject to some kind of Nuremberg trial. This was the man in charge of our global temperature data set. And we're supposed to think, oh, well, global warming, it's all about science and these evil deniers. The man in charge of it was endorsing stuff that sounded like it was written by the Unabomber. That's the agenda we're dealing with. This is all agenda. The EU climate commissioner has said even if we're wrong on the science, we're doing right by policy on global warming. Well, what does that mean? That means it doesn't matter whether global warming's happening or not. All that matters is we go for their policies. And what are their policies? Centrally planned global carbon taxation, moving toward, in their words, global governance. And that's the key word. Al Gore has used it. former French president Jacques Chirac has used that phrase. UN officials have used that phrase. And they've openly talked about how UN climate policies are essentially going to redistribute wealth. They're going to redistribute wealth by climate policy. It's unbelievable. And it doesn't stop with the United Nations. I just came back from West Virginia, the capital in Charleston, testifying against these Common Core science standards. And we lost. The West Virginia School Board tried to just allow the fact that there's natural variability, that scientists dissent, that climate models have failed. And the Common Core education establishment came out in force and intimidated and bullied the West Virginia Board of Education. So they had to overturn the slight skeptical changes, which were 100% accurate scientifically, because the Common Core science curriculum teaches kids from kindergarten through high school there is no debate and no dissent allowed on global warming.
Well, I see here also on climatedepot.com, there's a quote that points out that some of these Common Core educational standards are funded, ExxonMobil and Chevron. They've funded some of these.
Here's the irony of this. At this hearing, they were saying all skeptics were funded by ExxonMobil and the evil fossil fuel companies, which isn't true. In fact, the fossil fuel companies, the natural gas industry, gave more to the Sierra Club a few years back than the combined budgets of like the top three or five global warming skeptic organizations that ever received in the history of the organizations from fossil fuels. So it's just silly nonsense when they say that. But that's interesting because it's big corporate America that's funding these changes to our education. And that actually, you know, a lot of these oil companies and big energy companies, they support carbon taxes and other stuff that global warming skeptics, which tend to be conservative, libertarian, Cato Institute and others, would never support. So the idea that, you know, the evil industry money is tainting skeptics makes no sense when, you know, you could argue that the fossil fuel companies are giving more to environmentalists in order to look green than they've ever given to anyone opposed to the environmental agenda.
Right. It's definitely like funding both sides of the war there. Well, we see, obviously, we know that there's been, you know, Obama's targeting the oil and gas industry. He just has demanded massive reduction in methane emissions. What's the end game here, and what can people do?
The end game is very simple. John Holdren is Obama's science czar. In the 1970s, he wrote an article saying one of the hazards of a free society was too much energy too soon. And he, in this article, he lamented that people get in their car and drive down to the grocery store and get a six-pack of beer and drive home, as though this was the greatest transgression that could ever happen to the face of the earth. They want to radically transform our lives. And what they're going to start with is centrally planning our economies and our energy. And if you can get a chokehold on energy, which is what they're doing, they're closing existing power plants, and they're going to be heavily regulating new ones. They're not allowing expanded oil drilling in places like the Arctic and other places. And they now that gas prices are low because OPEC is flooding the market in order to try to hurt fracking industry, which has devastated, you know, the OPEC countries, hurting the OPEC countries. They want to do a huge gas tax. And are you ready for this, Leanne? Republicans in Washington are sounding very favorable to a gas tax. They're calling it a user fee. So finally, American consumers get a nice break when it comes to energy, and the government's going to move right in and start tacking on taxes. And then, of course, OPEC is going to stop flooding the market, and gas is going to go back up. But this time, you don't expect any repeal of gas taxes, do you? It is a collusion at this point between Obama and the Republican leadership and many of the Republicans. It's so appalling what's happening, and we're going forward with this. Their end game is to centrally plan our energy economy. If they can control, one scientist said it best, Richard Lindzen, he who controls carbon dioxide controls life. It's a bureaucrat's dream to control carbon dioxide. That was according to Richard Lindzen of MIT. That is the key, because they're going to be able to control everything from transportation to agriculture to waterways to airlines, to our cars, to our home heating, to every aspect of our life is going to be heavily regulated because of the urgent and immediate danger of global warming that they claim.
Right. And then when people do try to get off the grid or be self-sustainable, then they start figuring out how to tax those people and applying user fees. Oh, well, you're driving in your electric car and, you know, it's not getting enough income, so now we're going to tax you for the miles that you drive. And I mean, is there anything that we can do? It seems like everything we try to do to be good, good little citizens, I mean, it seems futile.
Yeah, well, they're interested in in controlling every aspect is the simplest way. But that's what Nancy Pelosi went to China and said, we need a complete inventory in every aspect of our lives to battle global warming. Now, the Japanese government has literally, their environmental minister is on record telling its citizens to go to bed an hour early. The German, to fight global warming, to lose less energy. The German climate advisor or the environmental minister, they did a whole public service announcement. And that, in these announcements, they basically said you should have make love in the dark in order to save electricity. UK is proposing carbon ration cards that your employers would issue each employee, and it would monitor your airline travel, your car mileage, your home energy use, and if you go above a certain amount, you owe money. If you go below, you get a kind of credit. Levels of control, they're going to be monitoring every aspect of our life. The German climate advisor said we need a CO2 budget for every man, woman, and child on the planet, administered by some international body, most likely the United Nations. This is the reason Václav Klaus, the former Czech Republic president who grew up under communism, said, with the fall of the Eastern Bloc communists and the Soviet Union, the greatest threat that the world faces to their freedom today is what he calls ambitious environmentalism, and particularly the climate change agenda and how they want to transform our lives. That's what Christina Siekerins, the UN climate chief, actually is on record as saying people need a complete transformation. And they laud China. The UN head lauds China as it for its ability to get things done and not have any interference from the messiness of democracy. And they like the way that China can move forward and make policies happen.
Right. Yeah, they have been lauding China a lot in the past, especially with the way that they repress all of the freedom of the press there and corral their citizens to do their bidding. Meanwhile, they're one of the most polluted nations that exists. So what does this mean? Should we all just go and get a horse and move to the middle of nowhere and hope that we can
just gouge our eyes out and give up?
No, actually.
What it really means is, this has to be opposed. I mean, unfortunately, our enemies are now not only President Obama and the United Nations, but it's going to include Speaker Boehner and Mitch McConnell. Because we have to fight the Republican leadership on this stuff. Historically, and the big problem we actually face is going to be the Republican presidential nominee. Here's the bottom line. Global warming skeptics have won every battle of this debate. Mm-hmm. We've won the science battle. So much so that Nobel Prize winners like Ivar Giavar, who endorsed President Obama for president, he won the Nobel Prize for physics, has reversed his view and is now skeptical of man-made global warming. And he says he's ashamed of his country, Norway, for giving a Nobel Prize to Al Gore and the United Nations. We've won the science debate. We've won all the policy battles. We've prevented cap and trade. We've prevented carbon taxes. We've prevented the ratification of the past UN treaty, the Kyoto Protocol. The problem is we would never prepared, and I mean we being global warming skeptics, for someone like Obama, who I believe will be the most transformational president since FDR. No one will come close. He surpassed Lyndon B. Johnson in terms of transforming America. When it comes to everything from health, healthcare, immigration, climate policy now, even foreign policy, what he's done through executive orders that Republicans will never have the guts, the fortitude, the balls, if you will, to ever overturn these. If they do overturn, they'll overturn some, but this is going to be a major advance. He's going to sign a UN treaty, and he's going to have it ratified or go into ratification under existing treaties so he doesn't have to submit it. He's doing deals with China without congressional consent, you know, climate deals.
Mm-hmm.
And the only way to stop him, you would need a strong Republican nominee, or at least an opposition party nominee, and I doubt a third party is going to win, in 2016 to stand up and say, I'm going to revoke all of these executive orders. I'm going to withdraw from the United Nations process. But here's the question. Chris Christie, likely Republican nominee, his own EPA in New Jersey, praised Obama's EPA policies. So I doubt it's going to be Chris Christie because he's reversed himself. He used to be a skeptic, and for political expediency, he became a global warming believer and talks about the consensus and everything else. Jeb Bush, I don't trust for a second on this. And the other one is Mitt Romney, who actually has John Holdren advising him and had Dina McCarthy and others that are in Obama's administration when it came to environmental policy. So the three mainstream frontrunners of Republicans are going to be very suspect, if not opposed, to skeptics on this global warming agenda. So we face a huge problem because if the next president is a Democrat or a weak Republican, which is likely to be one of those two,
right,
the EPA policies will be permanent. the UN commitments we make will probably go forward to decades, and we are going to be the global warming establishment will have won the global warming war. That's just the way it's going to go. They're going to have massive regulations on coal plants, on oil, on fracking, and they're going to have massive international entanglements. And the next president, being weak Republican or Democrat, will continue them. And that's the likely scenario, unless, you know, somehow we break that logjam.
Yeah, if we can just wake the people up to see the reality of this huge push for this agenda, this UN agenda. Well, Mark, thank you so much for joining us today, and we'll stay tuned, climatedepot.com. Be sure to call us back, get back with us if you've got any updates on what's going on. Thank you.
Thank you, Ann. Okay.
Well, there it is. Looks like we could be dealing with checkmate unless we do our part to push back against all of this indoctrination and propaganda. And, of course, one of the ways that you can do that is becoming a subscriber to the Alex Jones YouTube channel. If you are watching us on YouTube, hit the subscribe button. And then head over to prisonplanet.tv, and you can become a subscriber there, too. We're running a special. You can share your username and password with up to 20 people at the same time. And, of course, your membership helps us run this operation. Thanks so much for watching us tonight. We'll see you here again Monday at 7 p.m. Central. City of Austin tap water versus filtered City of Austin tap water.
I can, like, taste dirt in it.
God knows what's in this.
This has an aftertaste. Tastes like Austin water.
Yeah, it does. Ugh.
These people just sampled City of Austin tap water straight from the faucet. Next, we had them try a sample of tap water filtered with a ProPure G2.0 filtration system.
High quality H2O.
That one is better.
Tastes like nothing.
Yep, I know what good water tastes like. It's good water.
Most tap water contains added substances like fluoride, chlorine, Monsanto's deadly pesticide, glyphosate, and many others. Studies prove that these substances are linked to an assortment of major health issues, including tooth decay, lowered IQ, and even cancer.
It tastes like you're drinking out of the lake when you're drinking tap water.
Yeah, it has that processed flavor to it.
The ProPure G2.0 filtration system removes these deadly substances and many more, leaving only fresh-tasting, deliciously clean water.
Okay, this is very tasty.
It's good water.
Refreshing.
It's good.
Go to InfoWarsStore.com today. Use promo code WATER and save 10% off your ProPure purchase. Again, that's InfoWarsStore.com or call 1-888-253-3139.
You are watching the InfoWars Nightly News, which airs 7 p.m. Central at InfoWarsNews.com. And your support is helping us defend liberty worldwide.